Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The only item on our agenda today is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses on the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Tax Administration Scotland Bill. First, we'll hear from Eric Brown, Scottish Technical Committee, Chartered Institute of Taxation, Justine Riccomini, Head of Tax, Employment and Devolved Taxes, Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland, and Isabel D'Inverno, Tax Law Subcommittee Convener, Law Society of Scotland. I welcome you all to the meeting and thank you for your written submissions. We'll move straight to questions. So I'd like to ask, at the moment, there's about 150 current UK taxpayers identified who are likely to be registered for Scottish aggregates tax. Do you feel that's a fair reflection on the number of taxpayers that actually are, or do you think there are a number that have not quite been picked up yet? Just wondering if anyone's able to answer that question.
I'm afraid I don't know the answer to that, sir. There is, I'm interested in the figure you gave, there is a publicly available copy of the register of quarry companies registered for aggregates levy available on the revenue website, and perhaps that's where the number came from. It's an Excel spreadsheet which is available. I'm here to represent the Institute of Tax. I was a member of the, or I'm a member of the expert group that was advising on the bill. And I should also let you know that I'm a part-time consultant to Revenue Scotland. And before that, I was a lawyer for Revenue and Customs with quite a lot of experience of the litigation with the British Aggregates Association. In the course of the expert panel's meetings, I think there was some concern expressed by the British Aggregates Association representative in particular that there were unregistered sites from which aggregates were being taken, which were competing with their members locally. How much is being taken, how much of it was simply anecdotal and not very much, I'm afraid, other than that, I can't help you.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, actually, when I was asking the question, I should have said that I should really ask Isabel to answer it, because it was really her paper that actually mentioned that figure.
Unfortunately, I don't think I have any more information than was included in our paper.
I'll move on a wee bit to also on your paper in section 4.10. One of the issues that has obviously been raised is the issue of potential cross-border issues relating to differential taxation. Now, we went on a visit a couple of weeks ago and we were told that, well, there's not really much cross-border because, the tax is like £2 a tonne and it costs a lot more to actually pay the wages of a driver and, you know, have a truck and put petrol in it and all that and ship it hundreds of miles than the £2 would actually impact. But you've actually pointed out in your submission that Scottish exports far more aggregate to the rest of the UK and imports over 5.5 million tonnes compared to 16,000 we import, which is obviously a colossal differential. So I'm just wondering, I mean, I take it these are aggregates that can't be sourced elsewhere in the UK. And you also go on to talk about the, because of the way the bill is structured and relations between the UK and Scottish governments will operate, Scotland could lose up £8 to £10 million a year in revenue. I just wonder if you can expand on that a wee bit.
I guess it's really difficult to predict how things would work if aggregates, or when aggregates tax is introduced here, and if there are different rates and so on, and companies may organise their affairs differently. But I mean, these were just estimates of how much it could be affected if aggregate from here was actually taxed in the, not in Scotland, but in the rest of the UK.
Okay. Now, one of the issues, actually, Justine, that you're concerned about is impact potentially on other taxes, is that right? LBTT, for example.
We're talking about the offsetting mechanism.
Yes,
now.
Indeed. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that's not something we've really taken any evidence on so far, so I'm quite interested in hearing your view on the public record.
Sure. I think the concerns that we have at ICAS are around, as you know, the second part of the bill wasn't consulted on.
Yes, indeed.
So, had it been, we'd probably have made the case at that time that the offsetting proposals, I think that what Revenue Scotland is trying to do, which comes from our conversations with Mike Patterson at various meetings that we've had, is to sort of emulate the provisions within Section 130 of the Finance Act of 2008, which allows for offsetting of debts against credits across taxes. And I think the explanation that we had when we were having meetings with Revenue Scotland and Scottish Government about this was that the proposal was to offset taxes, or any tax, against any other tax. So I guess the question that I had at that time, which I still have, is, you know, there's two fully devolved taxes, and there's potentially another two in the pipeline in terms of the building safety levy and Scottish aggregates tax. So given that they're all fairly low level taxes in the first place, they're not huge mainstream big hitters like income tax and VAT. What are the likely incidences of even needing to use a piece of legislation like that to offset debts against credits? I think Revenue Scotland's statistics overall show that, generally speaking, they seem to be relatively successful at collecting the two devolved taxes that they currently administer and collect. So I'm not really sure why they need that piece of legislation right now at this stage. I just felt that it was probably maybe a little bit premature.
You've actually said in your paper that it appears somewhat heavy-handed, and I have to say, I think Mr. Brown and Eric and Isabel are saying much the same in their submissions in that regard as well. And I mean, I think my understanding is, and we'll obviously take evidence from Revenue Scotland subsequently, but collection rates are about 98-99% for the other taxes, so I can understand what you mean. I'm just wondering if Eric and Isabel can comment on that particular part of the bill as well.
I think I have a slight issue with the provision on offset for this reason. When the Section 130 of the Finance Act 2008 was originally introduced in Parliament in Westminster, it was statutorily it was territorially limited to England, Wales and Northern Ireland. The territorial limitation was deleted or abolished in the Finance Act 2016, so that it was only since then that the provisions in Section 130 regarding offset applied to Scotland. You would see from the explanatory notes to the France Bill 2016 that the reason why the territorial limitation was abolished was to provide consistency across the UK, although it had been felt prior to then that the Scottish common law of set-off had been perfectly adequate. In other words, Inland Revenue before 2005 and Revenue and Customs after that had considered that the Scottish common law of set-off was perfectly adequate for the needs of a taxpayer, for example, owed VAT, an amount of VAT, but the revenue were due a repayment of corporation tax, then you could set off the one amount against the other simply under common law. There was no need in Scotland for the Section 130 provisions, which are essentially being replicated in this bill. So I just wonder why it is that Revenue Scotland consider the need, the power of the common law had been thought perfectly adequate by...
Okay, Isabel?
I think our concern, I mean, I would echo what Justine said about the lack of consultation on these, on the part two of the bill. So in relation to set-off, we note that there don't seem to be many protections for taxpayers in the legislation that's proposed here. It seems to allow Revenue Scotland to offset both, you know, amounts of LBTT against other amounts of LBTT, but also across the taxes. But it doesn't really make it clear in the legislation that that would only be the case if everybody had agreed that the amounts were actually payable and there was no dispute about them. The Section 130 provisions in the UK legislation is not something that we are terribly familiar with, because we, I think, are conscious that they're not really used all that often. It's a sort of extreme measure type of provision. So we just question whether this is appropriate. It is probably important that even if it is introduced, there's a lot more protection for taxpayers. And I think we'd say the same about Clause 52, which is the overpayment relief claims. For LBTT, which is the tax I know most about, you can amend a return within 12 months if you've overpaid tax. But if 12 months has passed, then the only remedy you have is an overpayment relief claim. And this section in the bill is saying that you're not allowed to make an overpayment relief claim if you owe some other tax.
Yes, I mean, you've said in your submission that it's disproportionate, actually. Yeah. And the safeguards, which you touched upon further on, being saying, there do not appear to be any safeguards for taxpayers to deal with situations where the taxpayer may not agree they failed to pay an amount of tax because they do not believe the tax is payable. What kind of safeguards should there be introduced into this bill?
I think in relation to both sections, really, there'd need to be provisions sort of setting out when it was the case that a liability had been determined. You know, whether it was that all appeals had been worked through and so on and so forth, which doesn't appear to be in the bill. So there would need to be that kind of protection. I think in the HMRC guidance that relates to Section 130, it does talk about that in some detail. These just seem very powerful provisions in the hands of Revenue Scotland with no sort of protections for the taxpayer.
Okay, thank you. Now, Eric, you've said that we would suggest that further controls are placed upon the system of credits with interactions between Scottish aggregate tax and UK aggregate levy to introduce the likelihood of potential abuses taking place. I'm just wondering if you can tell us a bit more about that.
The main difficulty which there are with the current provisions regards to the export of aggregates from Scotland. You touched on this already, but the, you mentioned a figure of about 5.5 million. I think in the Scottish Government information paper, the figures were something like 2.5 million tonnes were exported to England, and just over 3.7 million were exported to Europe. Most of that, and just to touch on your question about the costs and so on, most of those, as I understand it, are exported by ship. They go from the Glensander quarry in Morvern, or they go out of Moray, possibly from Invergordon or somewhere like that. And there's some exported by ship from Leith. The difficulty what is proposed is that if you have a Scottish quarry exporting to England, then they'll put in a return saying we're exporting to England. They claim a credit because the quarry is not going to be commercially exploited until it arrives at a site somewhere in England, and then it's going to be sold on after that, and that's where the commercial exploitation takes place, so the tax takes place in England and not in Scotland. Revenue Scotland, I think, will need powers to be able to investigate the supplier in Scotland, just as, for example, there are powers to Revenue in Scotland to check that matters which are claimed to be exported from the UK can be checked that they have actually been exported.
Of course, that's a real issue about the fact that if the tax is levied, obviously, after it's been sent down to England,
that's right.
I know then the UK government effectively gets the tax rather than the Scottish government gets
exactly
the tax.
So.
And that's why we're talking about possibly an £8 to £10 million lost to the Scottish taxpayer. That's
right, because if the figure was just over 2.5 million exported to England, you multiply that by two and you get £6 million figure.
Yeah, 5.5 million tonnes was obviously the figure that we got in the submission, but it's that'll vary year I would imagine as well. But so it'd be a ballpark figure. Now, Justine, you've said in your response that it's vital that Revenue Scotland policies compliance with the tax effectively, hopefully by liaising extensively with SEPA and ensuring that SEPA has the powers and resources it needs to regulate the aggregate sector and ensuring that appropriate sanctions are in place for non-compliant behaviours which affect fair competition. So you've obviously got some concerns about the way the system's operating at the moment. I'm just wondering if you could give us any specifics about how that could be improved through this bill.
I think to your original point about the number of registered operators, I think I have a member on my devolved taxes committee at ICAS who is something of an expert on aggregates, and she's brought a lot of concerns to that committee about unfair operations because of people being unregistered. And I think the point that she's trying to make is that SEPA, Revenue Scotland and the Scottish Government need to be perhaps a bit more cohesive in their overall policing of operators so that they can do more enforcement and more day-to-day policing, which obviously requires significant resource, because it would probably be most likely to be, rather than a sort of paper chase or a paper trail, you'd probably be requiring people to actually physically visit premises to see what's going on and how the operations are taking place and whether those operations are registered or unregistered, and only then, because at the moment it's a bit finger in the wind. We know who's registered, we don't know who's unregistered, and we never will unless we actually physically go out and check. So I think that's the concern that we have, is that there's not necessarily a level playing field, and that the resources that might be required to check on that are significant, especially seeing as we've said, Scotland is exporting more than it's importing. So there's an awful lot of aggregate potentially leaving Scotland that could be from an unregistered source, but we can't know that. Can I just quickly touch on the Section 130
point? Because
there was something that I forgot to mention, which was that I've been seeking a meeting with HMRC's debt management and banking team, the policy side of things, for quite a while now, just so that we and our collective counterparts can actually try and sort of speak to them and work out how often Section 130 is actually used, because I know that it's used, for example, in the pay-as-you-earn and NI offsetting mechanism, you know, where employers paying, overpaying, underpaying, this, that and the other. It's possible to offset that. It is possible to offset some, tweak a few bits of VAT. But generally speaking, as a collective of tax experts, we're not really aware of a massive amount of use of Section 130. We could stand corrected, but we're not really aware of it particularly. So it looks as if we may have a meeting coming up over the next week or so with HMRC to actually discuss that point and look at statistics and things like that. So I'm sorry it's come a little bit late for this particular meeting, because I have been trying to arrange it. But I think if I get more information, then I'll be able to comment on that later.
Yeah, we'd certainly be happy to receive that. We're expecting the Minister next week, so if we receive it before then, we can certainly put questions to the Minister. So I thank you for that. I mean, we've been told anecdotally about these unregistered quarries and stuff like that. I mean, Scotland isn't Russia, you know. It's not a vast kind of expanse of a country. It should be easily enough, one would have thought, to find a few unregistered quarries and tax them. Seems bizarre, and I mean, one would have thought that legitimate aggregate selling quarries would say, that guy down the road actually isn't he paying his taxes, what are you going to do about it, you know? So I'm actually, I don't know, what kind of scale are we talking about? Because it just seems, because we've been told that, you know, SEPA can be very finicky about, and pernickety about, you know, about the licences that registered aggregate producers have, and yet there seems to be almost a complete ignoring of those who are allegedly, you know, not registered and not paying any taxes. It just seems bizarre to me.
Yeah, I mean, I do tax. You know, I'm a tax bod. I'm not an aggregate.
Indeed,
you know,
indeed, of course.
Absolutely, but I think, you know, based on, as you say, anecdotal evidence, I think that there's obviously there seems to be something going on, and it just seems to be the case that perhaps some further investigation might be needed into that. And I'm not particularly sure of how far-reaching SEPA's powers are and how they can work more effectively, you know, more collaboratively perhaps with Revenue Scotland to make sure that what is supposed to be coming into the Scottish purse actually reaches the Scottish purse. So it might be worth having a little look at the overall kind of, you know, basket of powers that are currently available and seeing whether they need to be tweaked or something.
Okay. Yes, Isabel?
Just to say that the introduction of a new tax is a great opportunity to actually look again at how these things are done. And so it may be that there's a chance to sort of reel in some of the miscreants and get them registered and so on, because you know, there's a sort of starting again with the aggregates tax in Scotland.
Yes, it's indeed. Eric?
I think it's also worth bearing in mind SEPA have a big role in Scottish landfill tax. They don't have a similar role, as far as I'm aware, as regards quarries. So, for example, there isn't a Scottish register of quarries that SEPA holds. They would know who landfill tax operators are, but SEPA aren't tasked with quarries to anything like the same extent. They may know where the quarries are, but they don't have the same regulatory duties, I don't think, as regards quarries as they do landfill sites. Mm-hmm. There may be some quarry operators who operate landfill sites, but there's not a great... you know, if you do
it's
a Venn diagram,
there's
not a great common... commonality between landfill site operators and quarry operators.
Okay, I'm going to open it out the session to colleagues around the table now. First will be John, to be followed by Michelle.
Okay, thanks so much, convener. As a kind of general question, first of all, do you think the split here between primary legislation and subordinate legislation is correct, or should there be more in the primary or more in the subordinate? Mr. Venner? They're all looking at each other, yes.
Sorry, my background is tax, so most of it's old Westminster tax where they set out the rates in the legislation. That's not the policy of the Scottish Parliament, as I understand it. The rate tends to be set out by way of statutory instrument. Personally, I would have thought, from the point of view of transparency, the setting of the rates in the face of the bill would be a preferable approach. But
and then you'd need primary legislation every year to change it.
Exactly. And, you know, one of the things which I think comes through from all of our submissions is the need for the Scottish Parliament to consider having its annual finance bill.
Right. Which I'm sympathetic to, but I shall leave my colleague Liz Smith to ask you about that, because that's her baby when it comes to the committee. Fair enough. I mean, on the actual rate then, which you've mentioned, do any of you have views, or I mean, I accept you're not experts in aggregates, but one of the aims is to encourage recycling so that we take less out of quarries and we take more and reuse it. Do you think matching the UK rate is a good idea, or would it be a problem if we didn't?
I think I'd venture to say that it was probably a good idea, because what you really don't want is some sort of competition or tourism, or people avoiding taxes behaving in a different way because there's a different rate. And when we're talking about the movement of goods, aggregate, cross-border, I think it's probably a good idea if the rates are on a par. Mm-hmm.
And yet the downside to that is that the recycling industry are disadvantaged in many ways, and there's very little incentive to recycle. But it's cheaper just for people to get stuff out of the quarry.
Behavioural consequences, you've always got to take them into account.
Mr. Vernon, did you want to comment on that, any of that?
I think it is a bit of a balancing act, really, as to avoiding the aggregates tax tourism whilst also incentivising recycling. But it's a difficult... the law side doesn't normally comment on rates, so it's not really our bag.
Okay, I accept that. That's fair enough. Mr. Brown, you were already talking about some of the difficulties to the convener about pinning down when the aggregate is actually used, because that could be somewhere else in the UK or even beyond. I mean, would it have been better to make the tax at the source, so when the tax would be payable when it's taken out of the ground?
I think that there's a legal difficulty with that at the moment, because I think the way the Scotland Act provisions are for the devolution of the tax, you're not able to tax in Scotland something which might be sent somewhere else before it's before it's been commercially exploited. Yeah. Not so much down to England, but, say, to Europe, which I understand is where most of the aggregate that's exported goes when it goes out of Glen Sander. The other thing is that, and Glen Sander's a bad example in this respect, the other thing is that just because it's been taken out of the ground doesn't mean that you've got any money for it. Mm-hmm. You don't get any money for it until you've agreed a sale. What some of the... leaving aside the stuff that comes out of Glen Sander, what you have within the UK is you've got four very large producers who operate sites right across the UK. And what they will do, we're told or understand from the expert group, is that they'll dig something out of a quarry in place A and then transport it to a site for storage, which may be Firth of Scotland, in site B, where it's stored until such time as there's a customer comes along and says, I want 10 tonnes of whatever aggregate is you've got in that pile over there. So it's at the point of sale that the money is available to pay the tax, rather than the point at which the quarry stone comes out the ground.
OK, no, that makes sense. I mean, if either of the other two want to come in, by all means, but I've got another couple of questions, Mr Brown, for yourself. You mentioned in your submission you think there might be scope for confusion when the new tax is introduced. If I've got the right place, in 4.4 in your submission, until site operators and businesses are used to the new SAT and the interaction with UKAL, is that a serious concern? Do you think we need to do something around that?
I'm not sure now. I think that for Scottish operators who only sell aggregate within Scotland, all they're doing is paying the person to whom they write the cheques or send the money. It's no longer going from the UK. They're going to fill in essentially a similar return, and they're going to send an amount of money to Revenue Scotland rather than HMRC. I think there may be a difficulty for importers from the rest of the UK into Scotland. The amounts of product which are imported are very low. There's an issue, I think, perhaps in the bill. You've got section 26, which provides for the appointment of representatives by importers who are outside of the UK, but not representatives who are within the UK but Firth of Scotland. There's a provision in section 8 which deals with persons who might be liable to the tax, and that includes people within a chain. So you dig it out the ground, you send it to somebody where it's stored, you send it to somebody else, you send it to somebody else, and then finally it's the final consumer. Then there may be provision within section 8 which allows the Scottish government or to tax a Scottish customer who's taken the product, albeit it's been imported from England. But there's... I haven't made myself very clear on that. The point is that section 26 only requires the appointment of representatives by importers from outside the UK. It doesn't require other UK importers, Firth of Scotland, to appoint representatives to enable them to meet their obligations under the Act, under the Bill.
Right, well, maybe take that one up again with other people. ICAS make the point, and I did mean to declare that I'm a member of ICAS as well, about just the lack of awareness of Scottish taxes. I wondered if you could say who you think should be doing something about that. Is it just the media's fault that they ignore Scotland?
No, it's not the media's fault. We produced a paper a couple of years ago with CIOT, and we've just replicated that last year, in which we've done a little bit of research with the Diffley partnership about how many citizens or taxpayers in Scotland know about Scottish taxes and what they are and who administers them and everything. And actually what we discovered between the earlier paper and the current paper, that it looks as if awareness of Scottish taxes in general has actually gone down, which was a bit disappointing. But we have been, I think around the time of the Citizens' Assembly, we've been speaking to sort of various people in the Scottish Government, Tax Directorate and whatnot, over the last few years about, you know, how to get the messages out to engage the Scottish public and to actually get messages out about taxation. Bearing in mind that not everybody reads the Scottish Government's website on a daily basis and all that kind of thing. Right, okay. Surprisingly, I know. But, you know, absolutely. You know, it's very, very difficult for any government agency to actually work out how to get clear messages across about tax because, as we all know, people engage with tax when they have to. You don't go to school and become an expert in LBTT. You only become an expert in LBTT when you have to actually interact with the LBTT process. You're buying a property or selling one or something. So actually, you know, that situation in itself means that it's very, very difficult to raise awareness of Scottish taxes. But we have regular discussions with the Scottish Government guys about how to potentially get messages across. And how perhaps they could do something different with the comms process and engage with younger people and people at school. HMRC, for example, have a series of short videos on YouTube, which bizarrely nobody watches. I just can't understand it myself. But they're called tax facts videos, and we've suggested to the Scottish Government that they might want to produce something along similar lines because...
Even though no one will watch them either.
Yeah, no, but they could, you could actually produce them and actually, like, roll them out in schools or in colleges or universities for students who are actually about to, say, enter the workplace for the first time and understand that they're going to have a tax code and blah, blah, blah. Okay. You know?
No, I mean, I think that's helpful. It's a wider question than we're maybe looking at today, but I think that is interesting and it's quite helpful. Did you want to come in at this point, Ms. Devorno?
It was just to say that I understand one of the effective ways of raising awareness about taxes is to get them mentioned in the soap operas on television. So if that's a route that might also be considered...
I think I'll leave this line of questioning for the time being. If I can move on, the financial memorandum says that part two of the bill is cost neutral. I was interested to know if you all agreed with that.
Go first on that then, I guess. I think that the costs... they're going to be very hard to gauge... prior to the launch of the levy, because with any new tax, you've always got there's training and development to be undertaken, there's administrative costs on the side of the business as well as on the side of government, and there's always a degree of upfront cost involved, and obviously people need professional advisers, they need to pay fees to their accountants or their lawyers to help them to understand better how to comply with the system and operate it properly.
What about the rest of the bill, apart from aggregates tax? Would that be cost neutral, do you think?
I don't know if it would be entirely cost neutral for possibly the same reasons, because if there's additional powers being devolved to Revenue Scotland, I would say that there's a knock-on effect in a kind of Newton's law kind of way, where you've got you have some sort of action and then somebody has to actually react to that action, which usually involves some kind of cost. Mm-hmm. And with taxation, what you tend to find a lot of the time is that there's a larger upfront cost until everybody comes to terms with what it is they have to do,
yes,
and then it settles down. Mm-hmm. It was the same with the real-time information programme for pay-as-you-earn and NI. But it does tend to settle down, but then whenever there's a hiccup, there's a cost involved.
Yes. So. Do either of the other two have views about the part two costs? Are you comfortable with them?
I wouldn't have thought there was much cost involved in part two at all.
And the final area I think I wanted to touch on was this question of automation, that Revenue Scotland are going to be able to do more automation, and that, I think that's maybe got a few people a little bit concerned, if the computer's just going to churn out penalties and all that kind of thing. I mean, I'm thinking of, like, you know, I get cases with council tax where somebody has underpaid by a penny and then they get some horrible letter and threatening them with all sorts of penalties. If there's a danger of a lack of human interaction, do any of you have concerns around that?
I think it's probably better to have the use of automation actually contained in the legislation, provided that the tax authorities can react nimbly if things do go wrong. I mean, in your example of the council tax bill, you would think that the reaction to that should be to change the system so it didn't penalise people if they only owed a penny, type of thing. But there have been a number of cases about whether it is or isn't okay for something to be automated. So, given the society that we live in and the use of computers on such a widespread basis, it does seem appropriate that the tax authority should be able to automate what processes it can, but so long as somebody's looking out and making sure that if anything does go wrong, it gets fixed.
Yeah. Okay, I'll leave it at that, convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And that's Michelle, to be followed by Michael.
Good morning, everybody. Quite a few of the things I was going to raise have been picked up, so I'll be very quick. Just returning to Section 59, Part 2, under ancillary provision, I think it was yourself, Eric, in your submission, that said, and I quote, the ability of the executive to grant itself unfettered powers which might impose any further obligations on taxpayers must be contained within primary legislation. Would a finance bill alleviate your concern in this respect?
Yes, I think it's a short answer.
Okay.
Okay,
short question. In terms of the offset consideration, What do you think about establishing this as a principle? I accept what's being said about the relatively few number of Scottish taxes, but as a principle that one tax can be used to offset another, do you think there's merit in it as a principle on the basis that we can anticipate further taxes being devolved in the future?
Whether it's needed at this time, and there's always a danger with introducing things on a principle basis in tax that you can't really anticipate what taxes are going to come in the future, in what order, and so the legislation might not fit what's actually required.
But then as further taxes are introduced, would part of the scrutiny of that not be to how the detail and the complexity of offsetting with a further basket of taxes need to be considered?
One thing we have found quite difficult with the devolved taxes is the time that it takes to actually get anything changed where an issue has been identified. And that's one of the reasons we all are in favour of an annual finance bill type event, so that it's easy to get things like that changed, because that's the danger of saying, well, you know, it could be tweaked to fit new circumstances, but our experience is that it's pretty difficult to get anything in the devolved tax legislation changed.
Okay. Any other further comments about the principle as compared to the inaction from Justine or Eric?
My only point on this area, I think, is I wondered whether the Scottish common law of set-off wasn't sufficient already. As a principle, I don't have a problem with it.
Okay. That's me. Everything else has been covered.
Thank you very much, Michael. To be followed by Jamie.
Thanks, Kabir. Most of my area has been covered as well. I've been enjoying the idea of a storyline on River City of an illicit quarry, I think. Reeling in the miscreants around it, as Ms. D'Inverno said. I want to touch briefly on Section 55 in the automation area that John Mason raised. So the Chartered Institute of Taxation had some concerns that these were quite wide-ranging powers around automation, that perhaps that dealing with them here in short form rather than looking at them in primary legislation might be the wrong way to go around that. Would you care to comment further on that, Mr. Brown?
Not really. The more that's done in the tax sphere by statutory instrument, the less transparent, the less ability there is for people to consider it other than those who are dealing with the statutory instruments. And I think that my colleague has already said that there have been cases before tribunals about the use of automation, sending out automatic daily penalties, that sort of thing. So the more scrutiny there is around these issues, the better.
And is this a broader issue that your organisations have looked at in terms of the application of artificial intelligence or algorithm approaches to calculating some of these and people's interaction with the taxation system?
I don't have
Not
any,
so far?
No, I don't deal with artificial intelligence, I'm afraid.
Okay.
Involved to some degree with sort of the Making Tax Digital programme with HMRC and the Treasury. I think the main issues that we have with that is that we don't want everything to go digital at the expense of people who can't be digital yet or don't have the wherewithal to be able to deal by digital means with the authorities. But I would say what we really need is very clear-cut legislation on exactly how those powers would work and what protections would be there for the taxpayer so that it's clear to everyone exactly, you know, what rights of appeal do you have when something goes wrong and how long is it going to take to fix it.
And do you feel that Section 55 deals with that? It doesn't really encompass what you're suggesting.
I think it could probably do to have a bit more sort of thought given to how the powers can be constructed. So the main thing is clarity for the taxpayer, yeah. Because the clearer things are, the easier it is to understand, the greater the compliance.
Ms. D'Inverno?
I think, to be fair, the Section 55 provisions are enabling provisions, and my understanding is that following on from them, there would be consultation about the use of automation by Revenue Scotland, and so there would be an opportunity for everybody to think about it, and so hopefully at the end of that process there would be some more detailed legislation which had been widely considered and so on. But I mean, if automation provisions were to just turn up next week and be introduced to the Parliament, that wouldn't be great because it is quite complicated to make sure there's... So, as I say, my understanding is that in the future there will be a consultation about the use of automation.
Okay, thank you. That's good.
Thank you. Jamie to follow by Liz.
Thanks very much. Good morning. I just wanted to ask, regards to, I suppose, the financial implications of this, the FM, or it seems that we don't have specific data from HMRC on the numbers, the amount of money raised by the UK levy from Scotland. We've had a number of issues in this committee and others around data from HMRC. Do you find that surprising that they're not able to give a more accurate picture. And the, in the FM, the Scottish Fiscal Commission estimates around about Scotland's share of UCAL around about 60 million, raising to 61 million in 2025-26. Do you think that's accurate?
My understanding is that there were statistics produced by HMRC, I'm not sure how long ago, where there was a disaggregation of the different taxes across the UK, how much tax was raised in the different parts of the UK. And I think that the 60 million for aggregates levy came from those revenue statistics.
Right.
How more recently information has been sought from HMRC about the disaggregation of the aggregates levy as far as Scotland is concerned, I don't know, but my understanding was that the 60 million came from the revenue statistics on the disaggregation of the different taxes.
Okay, I don't know if anybody else wants to ask on that. You don't know?
What I was going to say was that we've had similar issues with this, for example, on the VAT assignment issue. You know, HMRC don't keep regional statistics on it, so it was to try and work out a methodology for aligning, you know, for assigning VAT to Scottish purse was exceptionally difficult, and in the end, of course, we know it didn't happen. So it doesn't surprise me that they don't keep regional statistics on this either. There is a case for augmenting the need for HMRC's systems to be updated so that regional statistics can be produced, and that doesn't just go for Scotland, it goes for all the regional areas of the rest of the UK as well, where devolution is taking place in a number of different areas over a number of different subjects, not just taxation.
I suppose just it makes it harder. I mean, if we're looking at the replacing of a UK aggregates levy of which Scotland gets a share, which is determined, and will now, through this new legislation, Scotland will the money will be raised in Scotland, but the money will come off, or will be reflected in budget. I suppose the question is: is there any? How can we be sure that this is actually going to be of any real benefit? Unless there is a difference in the amount raised, which of course has its own implications in terms of Scottish businesses. If there's a higher rate in Scotland than, you know, in England,
you're quite right, sir, to raise that. Taking the figure of 60 million in terms of the overall Scottish budget, that's not a lot of money. In terms of the further quirk that there is over Scottish aggregates exported to England and the loss of revenue within that 60 million, then that's an even smaller amount. Mm. I don't know if it's small enough to get lost in the rounding of the negotiations over the Barnett formula payments. Mm. I simply don't know. I do recall that when Scottish landfill tax was first considered, I think more time was spent, there were only two issues that really concerned the committees in the Parliament, and the main one was what about waste tourism? If we have a different rate in Scotland or to that in England, is there going to be waste going up the M74 or down the M74? I'm not sure if the same issue arises as regards exports, but I'm not sure, given what the industry says about the cost of transport, that putting an extra 10 pence on the rate is really going to make a difference. Whether it's a pound or £3 again, I simply don't know, because the industry will know how their costs are calculated.
Yeah, you highlighted obviously the issues where if exporting to England, that money is collected by the UK aggregates levy. Under the UK aggregates levy, was exports to Europe, you've talked about the percentage there, is that covered under that, or is that not covered? It has to be.
Exports to Europe would be exempt already under the UK levy.
Right.
So there's no aggregates levy taken in respect of the rock that goes from Glen Sander to Europe, because it's exempt under the UK aggregates levy. So it's not calculated in the 60 million figure that was talked about, because it was never collected in the first place.
But a destination country might have its own levy
precisely.
Okay, I was just wondering whether we lost.
Exactly the reason. Yeah.
So looking, I suppose, very generally at this legislation, unless there is a variation in the rate, which obviously would be aimed either at raising more tax or for environmental reasons, the recycling reasons, is there any real benefit from this legislation? Anyone can feel free to answer that.
It does give the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government, the ability to fashion the tax in the way that better suits Scotland.
What is that? I mean, practical reasons. Where do you say it? I mean, because the Scottish Government, I mean, looking at their website. I don't look every day, but I did look at their website, and obviously they rightly highlight that there's more money being raised in Scotland, but it's not necessarily more money being raised or coming to Scotland. It's just how it's being raised. Is there anything apart from that kind of tailoring? But that then requires differentials that might impact more widely.
It's not my specialist area at all to know how the sort of numbers will play out. But I mean, the experience of LBTT has been that it's been possible to do things in a way which were more suitable for Scots law and conveyancing practice, as the term goes.
Okay.
It gives the Scottish Parliament some practice at tax.
I think I'll leave it there.
Convinced that's really the rationale behind it, but I will certainly, there's questions we can put to people like the Minister when he comes next week, for example. That's an obvious one to put to him and possibly Revenue Scotland in the next session. No further questions, Jamie? We'll just move on to Liz. Liz?
Thank you, Judge. Just one question, really. And this is about the behavioural change possibility that has been flagged up to us by other witnesses. And I think the general message we're getting is we're not going to be predicting terribly much behavioural change in the way that people operate. Having said that, are you aware of any behavioural changes that have happened in the UK aggregates levy, which I think has been around for about 20 years, am I right? Has there been any instances of the UK tax changes that's had a marked effect on elasticity of demand or whatever that has affected revenues? Are we aware of any comparable studies there?
I'm not aware of any.
Okay. Yeah, we're not predicting that there's going to be behavioural change. Right. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Just exhausted questions from members. Oh, sorry, John had one to come in, and I did actually have a note of that, actually, John. It's straight a minute.
Just, one brief thing. We haven't really touched on some of the other things that the Law Society had suggested, things that are not in the bill, and the whole area around LBTT group relief and Scottish share pledges. Now, I confess I do not fully understand all of this, but I think you're looking for amendments maybe that could have been there, or you're looking for something that could have been in the bill. Have you got amendments ready to go that one of us might be willing to lodge?
Not as such, but they could be drafted very quickly. I think the whole point of this is that we're told, because of the scope of the bill being devolved taxes administration, Scotland bill, it isn't, the scope of it couldn't include changes like the ones we've mentioned. However, the scope of the, I don't know what extent it's possible for the scope of the bill to be changed, but there are quite a few things where it would have been an opportunity to include them in this bill, or it could be an opportunity to mm-hmm. include them in this bill. But we haven't drafted proposed amendments, but we certainly could do, if that would be helpful.
Okay, I mean, it does seem quite wide-ranging to me, so I'm surprised that anything is ruled out in a sense, but fair enough, we can take advice on that. Thank you, that was all.
Yeah, I mean, as long as it doesn't contradict the general principles of the bill, I don't see why there would be an issue about any amendments, but obviously that would be a matter for the presiding officer to decide, I would think. Anyway, as I was saying before, I forgot that John wanted to come in with that question, which I didn't know of. Are there any other issues that you wish to highlight individually that we haven't touched on that you feel should be on the record from this morning's session?
I do feel quite strongly, Christine. I do feel quite strongly about the notion of a finance bill in Scotland, because the problem with part two of the bill is the fact that there's a lot of miscellaneous provisions in there, and with any luck there might be a couple more, which actually don't really have anything to do with aggregates tax. So when you're somebody like myself, and years down the line you remember that there was a miscellaneous provision somewhere that changed Revenue Scotland's powers or brought something else in or whatever, you can't find it because it's buried deep in another bill that doesn't really have anything to do with the subject that you're talking about. Whereas if there was a finance bill introduced on a regular periodic basis, it would be so much more transparent for everybody concerned to be able to just go to that one piece of legislation and dig it out. And also, if we're talking about engaging with the public and, you know, and sort of making Scottish taxes more easily understandable, then that's definitely, in my opinion, the place to put them.
Aye, that's an issue that Liz has raised. I've raised it as well. A number of other colleagues have raised that issue, so that's certainly something to take on board. Anything, other points that people want to highlight that haven't come up so far today? Anything else?
No? Covered the points that are...
No. Isabel?
They do.
I think most of the points have been covered. Certainly, we would agree with ICAS that a system in which there was an annual finance bill type event and an opportunity to make changes would be helpful. At the moment, I think the Scottish Government is dealing with 6 new taxes, if you add them all up, which is quite a lot of new taxes. So, you know, there is probably a growing need for the finance bill type approach. So that, as well as it being easier to locate where things are, there's a timetable that people can feed into so that people can make representations about things that perhaps could be included in this year's finance bill and things of that nature. Because I have to say that we did all get quite a surprise when we read these provisions in part two of the bill. I think a sort of lead-in process would have been preferable.
Okay, well, thanks very much for that, and thank you very much for your evidence this morning. We'll now have a break until 10:40. Thank you. Well, during the second part of our evidence session on the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Tax Administration Scotland Bill, we hear from Revenue Scotland, and therefore welcome to the meeting Elaine Lorimer, Chief Executive, John McVeigh, Programme Manager, and James Lindsay, Scottish Aggregates Tax Design Project Manager, Revenue Scotland. And I understand Ms Lorimer would like to make a short opening statement. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, everybody. Thank you for your invitation to join the committee this morning. We appeared before the committee in December, and we very much welcome the opportunity to discuss Revenue Scotland's role in the introduction of Scottish aggregates tax and the provisions with the relevant bill. It's my privilege to represent Revenue Scotland today alongside John McVeigh, Programme Manager, and James Lindsay, Tax Design Lead for the aggregates tax within Revenue Scotland. Now, as you know, Revenue Scotland is Scotland's tax authority, currently responsible for the management and collection of two fully devolved taxes, Lands and Buildings Transaction Tax and Scottish Landfill Tax. This will be our third devolved tax, and we've worked closely with colleagues from the Scottish Government Bill team throughout the development of the bill. Crucial to this has been the close engagement with the aggregates industry representatives, and we've again worked with our Scottish Government colleagues in planning, establishing and facilitating the expert advisory group, which has afforded us an insight into the workings of the industry, the challenges it faces, and how we may administer and deliver Scottish aggregates tax in a way that supports good practice and the establishment of the level playing field, which we are advised is a critical element for the aggregates community. We've established a programme of work which has laid solid foundations for the operationalisation of aggregates tax. Our programme team's been in place since the last year, with the underpinning projects defined and initiated, and our programme board will meet for the fifth time this Thursday. The board includes representation from key areas both internal and external to Scottish Government, and supports our head of tax, who's unfortunately not able to be with us today, in his role as SRO, and we have clear governance and escalation rules established to support effective decision-making. I think important for the committee to also know is that we'll benefit from the rigour of gateway reviews and digital assurance mechanisms to make sure our delivery plans are both robust and that our approach is in line with the expectations of a modern, digitally enabled public body. We're shortly entering our 10th operational year as a tax authority, and our ethos in delivering this tax will be informed by our experience to date, as well as looking to embrace the opportunities technology and data brings. So work is underway in gathering requirements for the development necessary to our tax collection system, and we're about to commence discussions with industry representatives on more detailed requirements, such as the design of the tax return. We have plans in place to continue this engagement through to delivery and beyond. And user-centred design, as I hope you'd expect us to say, will be a key component of our work, as we will be making sure that by the time Scottish aggregates tax goes live in Scotland, taxpayers, their agents and Revenue Scotland is ready. We also welcome the measures included in Part 2 of the Bill and see these as responsible and mature technical measures which reflect the changing landscape for tax administration in Scotland. And as I said in my written evidence to the committee submitted last week, we work closely with SG, the Scottish Government, to support and implement legislation and changes in line with the Scottish Government's policy aims. The measures in Part 2 reflect an aspect of that joint work on technical and future-proofing matters which will support the establishment of Scottish aggregates tax whilst also ensuring operational coherence across the devolved taxes. And so we're delighted to have this opportunity to engage with the committee today. Look forward to sharing our progress today, our plans in place, and hopefully being able to answer your questions as fully as possible.
Thank you very much for that very upbeat and interesting opening statement. I'm just going to refer to that first of all, as I ask questions and open out the session to colleagues around the table. I mean, you've said that Revenue Scotland has worked closely with aggregates industry representatives, and you've talked about how they've emphasised the need for a level playing field across the UK. But of course, other people have a different view on that. So, for example, you know, the Scottish Environmental Services Association and Resource Management Association Scotland argued in favour of an increased rate of tax in Scotland to incentivise a wider adoption of recycled aggregate, and ask where possible for the two governments to work together to bring about a UK-wide increase in the aggregates tax and levy if it's, you know, initially they would like that, but if not, they would like Scotland to increase taxation on non-recycled primary aggregates in order to fulfil the Scottish Government's objective of switching more production and sale to and usage to secondary recycled products. So, have you had much contact, you know, with organisations like those?
Do we have, convener? And if you're looking for more information on our engagement with industry, both John and James will be able to provide that. But in relation to the point about level playing fields, what we're hearing from the aggregates industry is how the existing tax operates in Scotland. And we are hearing that from some of them, they feel there is a lack of a level playing field. And that is as a result of non-compliance with the existing tax regime. So where we think we can make a difference in Scotland is going to be in relation to our approach to compliance. And that starts from making sure that the taxpayers and their agents understand their obligations, irrespective of what the tax is, what the rates and bands are. And then from our perspective, it's making sure that through our compliance work, the taxpayers know what their obligations are and they pay the right amount of tax. And so what we are hearing from the industry at the moment is that's not consistent across the industry in Scotland. So the level playing field the industry is looking for is one whereby everybody is adhering to the tax regime, that is in place, so that they have a level playing field for competing for business. That's the point about level playing field. But in relation to the engagement with the industry representative bodies, if you would like, I can bring James in, who can talk about that.
I can talk to that. Yeah, so we've had a close working relationship with the Scottish Government as part of their stakeholder engagement throughout the bill process, the development of the bill. And so they introduced a working group that brought together a lot of different parties, including the body you mentioned there. So we've had discussions with those environmental bodies at that point in time. A lot of our focus has been on compliance, of course, and the calculation and payment of the tax, which, of course, these environmental bodies, they're exempt from the tax, from the exemption provided within the bill. So, yeah, our engagement has been through the Scottish Government's stakeholder engagement at this point in time.
OK, we're actually talking about, I think, we're conflating two things here, really. One is the issue about whether the Scottish aggregates tax, when it comes in, will incentivise the switch to recycled secondary products so that there's less natural products used. The other issue which you mentioned is compliance. Now, I think everybody around this table wants those who are actually producing these aggregates who are not currently paying taxes to pay those taxes. I mean, I think that's absolute, and I think everyone in the industry who's legitimate in doing that. So I think, so I commend the Revenue Scotland are determined to ensure that happens. I'll switch back to that in a second, but with regard to the initial question I was asking about a differential in taxation, we appreciate, of course, that recycled they won't be paying tax, and there's issues about whether or not, for example, you know, local authorities should be paying the tax. There are other issues, but one of the things that, for example, happened with the landfill tax was the whole idea was to try and encourage a change in behaviour, and that's kind of happened over a kind of UK basis, but the tax has never varied between Scotland and England. But in terms of the policy memorandum in this bill, it says that it's to ensure that the devolved tax can evolve over time to support Scottish Government circular economy objectives, and then it goes on to say that they want to encourage the maximum necessary necessary exploitation of primary aggregates, maximising the use of secondary and recycled aggregates, and incentivising innovation and developing development of alternative materials. Now, the tax on aggregates has been £2 a tonne since 2009, regardless of inflation and all the rest of it. And it's gone up to a thumping £2.03 next month. You know, so I'm just wondering, is that actually happening, and how will £2 a tonne across the board in Scotland, the same as England, possibly have any impact on behaviours? This is what those who wish to see more recycling products want to see.
Yeah, if I can come in initially, and John might want to come in after me. I mean, obviously, the setting of rates and bans and the policy behind the tax is not within my remit. That's for ministers and for Scottish Government. We're aware of what the industry is saying there in terms of supporting the circular economy and how that, you know, the powers that are being devolved to Scottish ministers could be used differently. But it's for ministers to determine how they wish this tax to set off. And it's clear at the moment what they're looking for is parity.
I appreciate that, and I realise Revenue Scotland is there to implement Scottish Government policy, but it's just from your opening statement, it appears to be that and I may have read this wrong in terms of your submission also, that it's almost saying, well, OK, we'll just go ahead with that, rather than actually querying whether that's the right thing to do, whether the ministers are being advised that this is the way forward. Because, I mean, you know, ministers do listen to what Revenue Scotland has to say. It's not a one-way kind of conversation.
So our involvement in the discussions around the policy within the bill have been more around the management and the administration elements of the bill rather than rates and bans and what you might do in relation to that. That really is a matter for ministers. Our role will be to implement whatever it is that Parliament chooses to pass.
And I mean, we'll put those to the minister next week. I mean, because from a financial memorandum, table one, it says basically in the current financial year, £60 million would be raised in over the next 5 years. That's going to increase to £64 million, which doesn't seem to me that if we, you know, assuming taxes remain the same, that there's going to be much switch to secondary products at all. It looks almost as if it's as steady as she goes. Is that an accept? Do you think that's a reasonable assumption from looking at financial
memorandum? I think on the basis of our understanding of what is within the financial memorandum and how the tax is expected to be introduced at this stage, the projections that are there in terms of revenues are in line with what you're saying, yes.
Okay, now, the other thing which I think was music to our ears in terms of compliance, one of the things we've tried to grapple with is the size of this scale, because I mentioned to the earlier panel, it's not as if Scotland's a huge, big country where you can hide thousands of quarries everywhere, like, you know, Canada, you know, or Russia, or somewhere like that. I mean, Kazakhstan, for God's sake. I'm not going to just rhyme off lots of big countries, but Scotland's a country of 30,000 square miles. I mean, it should be pretty easy to know where all the quarries are and who's paying tax and who's not. So, have you any idea of the kind of scale of the challenge in terms of addressing these and what is going to be done to ensure that they actually do pay their whack?
Yeah. So, this tax is going to be different from us for us to administer in comparison to the other two taxes that we've got because of the geographical spread of the industry. So there are five times more taxpayers for aggregates as we expect than there is for landfill, for example. We expect there to be around 350 known quarries as opposed to a much smaller number of landfill sites. So in terms of our approach to compliance around this, it's going to have to be slightly different. We'll want to make sure that we have our ear to the ground geographically around Scotland, because there are quarries all over Scotland, including the island communities. And so as part of our compliance approach, we'll be wanting to use as much technology as we can to identify where quarries are and to work with taxpayers directly to understand their industry and basically get to know the industry really, really well so that we're able to undertake our compliance in a proportionate way. But the difference between this tax and landfill tax, for example, for us, is yes, it's going to be similar in the sense that we will be engaging with business as we do with landfill tax, but where it will be different is the geographical spread.
But surely we've got 32 local authorities. They must know which quarries they have in their area.
Indeed.
Surely that would be the first point of contact. Which quarries do you have? And they can check whether they're registered and paying taxes or not, or whether they aren't, and then action can be taken. I mean, the authority would be that. It's not that you've got to fly a drone all over Scotland inch by inch to try and locate them and then check off a list.
No.
I thought, surely, you know, that might, everyone must know if there's a quarry at the end of their street or not. I mean,
exactly. So, yes. So we won't be doing this in isolation. So one of our approach with all of our taxis is to work in a very collaborative way. So what we've identified with this industry is there are a number of key players within it that we will want to be working closely with. Local authorities are absolutely key to this for us. So it's not as if Scotland, Revenue Scotland will be sitting in isolation. So we've identified other key stakeholders such as SEPA, such as the Health and Safety Executive and local authorities, to name but three. We'll be wanting in our compliance approach to be engaging with all of them.
And what kind of is the general sense of the scale of these unregistered quarries that are not, that even though tax have been in for 22 years, they're not paying any tax?
I'm going to ask James or John. Do you have any idea? Do you want to come in, John?
I couldn't comment on the scale of the unregistered quarries, but what we've heard quite extensively from the industry is that this can manifest itself in a couple of ways, mainly, where one being quarries which have extended beyond their boundary and are continuing to quarry outside that permitted boundary. And then another problem is almost like a pop-up quarry where materials are taken from can be a farmer's field, used in construction, and then the field filled back in. So we're aware of those two types of issues. The evidence we've heard from the industry representatives is that the result of this can be they're competing for tenders with contractors who aren't using registered sites and aren't paying their tax. And that becomes very difficult then for them to compete when they put their tender in. So we've heard of this since the programme commenced last July. That's been a regular topic of conversation with the industry representatives. So the feeling we have is that it's quite a hot topic and that it is quite extensive, but we don't have that detail as yet. But those are two examples of how this can work in practice.
Yeah, because, I mean, it seems to me to be, just anecdotally, to be a bigger issue than the cross-border issue because, I mean, we visited a secondary quarry as such, but a processor, if you like, of recycled aggregates, and they said, well, you know, because of the cost of transport, you know, we don't even sell to Edinburgh. It's too far away in terms of the money they would make. So, given the fact that the borderlands both sides are fairly depopulated and don't really use much aggregates, then it would cost so much to export. This cross border thing's a bit of a myth. The only place it would really be an issue would really if you're actually shipping it in big, from big quarries. Sander was quoted in the previous session. So how much of an issue is that? I mean, what you've said in section 4.15 of your submission is that we're working with stakeholders, the bill team and HMRC, to identify the different types of cross-border arrangements in order to establish the most effective and efficient way to administer the tax in those situations. So I'm just wondering what those effective and efficient ways to administer are following your deliberations.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to ask James to come in.
Thanks, Kevin. So we've had close collaboration again with the Scottish Government, HMRC and industry stakeholders in order to establish the different types of arrangements and different types of cross-border transactions that can occur. And we're currently looking to set those out. And as part of our compliance strategy and processes, the best ways to deal with them. So at this point in time, we're looking we're very much in the investigatory stage to try and establish what are the biggest risks with regard to cross-border, and then down to the very kind of minutiae of the different types of arrangements that someone could get could be administratively difficult for them, so that we can make sure that when that task goes live, we have the best process in place to deal with it.
So, have you any evidence, anecdotal or otherwise, that if the tax went down a pound, for example, Scotland would just flood England with all these aggregates because you would be saving a pound a ton, or if it went up to £3, would there be the opposite, and Scotland would be flooded, or would there be actually very little difference? Of course, the difference would be that if it was an extra pound, it might encourage more people to invest in recycling facilities and bring more money in terms of revenue to the Scottish Government. So where's the elasticity in that?
Do you want to comment?
Are you able to answer that?
Well, yeah, I can answer that. So we don't have any specific data on that. As you say, it would be anecdotal at best, but it's...
Hold on a second. I mean, given the fact that we've got a bill in which we're actually trying to devolve this tax and trying to get the optimum level of revenue, is that not something that's fundamental to try and ascertain?
In terms of the cross-border movements?
Well, yeah, the impact of tax changes in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK and on our revenue streams.
Yeah, that'll come in relation to that. I mean, that again is a matter for our colleagues in Scottish Government and ministers to take a view on. It's perhaps something you might want to...
No, it's not about to take a view on a policy. It's about what is the actual... Surely Revenue Scotland have an idea of what the impact would be of that. If you're going to be collecting the revenue, surely you have an idea. You would be saying to ministers, well, Minister, if we actually raise or lower the tax, this will be the impact in terms of the revenue that we expect to come in or not, as the case may be.
We would be able to, in that situation, we would do our best to be able to provide information to the Minister on the basis of our knowledge of the tax at the moment. But I mean, this is early days for us in terms of understanding the industry and understanding how the money flows work within the industry. So it's perhaps a question that's a bit early for us to be able to answer right now. It's the sort of thing that as we build up industry knowledge, we would be much more expert in being able to provide a view. Ultimately, though, of course, forecasting is not for us. Forecasting is for ministers and, you know, obviously the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who are also providing information in relation to this tax.
Well, I note that the financial memorandum includes £25,000 for the Scottish Fiscal Commission actually to specifically do that forecast, you know. So I appreciate what you're saying there. I mean, you've said in section 5.4 of your submission, you talk about the Scottish Parliament acting a legislative scheme with teeth to challenge non-compliance. What kind of teeth would you like to see in this bill that may not be in it at the moment?
Basically, the moment in relation to the compliance powers that we have, you know, they're set out within the Revenue Scotland Tax and Powers Act. And we believe that the compliance powers broadly that we've got within that legislation will apply for us here. There are some specifics that we're seeking for changes to, which is related to in part two. I'm going to turn to James just in case there's anything else. There's one specific provision, I think, is there not, in relation to...
So as part of the... I think the reference to the teeth there was a kind of broader reference to the Revenue Scotland Tax and Powers Act and the ability for the penalty regime, for example, is an example of the teeth that the powers that the legislation has. In terms of the bill itself, we welcomed an introduction by the Scottish Government of a provision, I think it's section 8, subsection 5, from memory, which seeks to deal with some of the non-compliance we talked about earlier with regards to unregistered taxpayers, and that will help us with our compliance approach. And I think the state part 2 provisions are there as maintenance and as there to help us with efficiency and with our administration.
Now, in terms of those part 2 provisions, I mean, you'll be aware, because I'm sorry, sitting at the back, actually, James, you know, of the concerns that have been raised by our previous panel, you know, Chartered Institute of Taxation, you know, the Law Society of Scotland, Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland, who talk about the fact that, the lack of safeguards for taxpayers in such a situation whereby, and particularly in terms of, you know, the kind of whereby if you fail to pay a tax in aggregates, you may therefore be, it may impact on other taxes that you pay. What's your view on that?
So these are the provisions I think you're referring to.
Yeah, it's in the part 2 of the bill.
Part 2 provisions. Is this the set-off provisions in particular
that
you're referring to, convener? Yeah, I understand. So set-off is something which we believe would be a useful additional clarification of our powers as a tax authority. Essentially, where set-off would come into effect would be where there is no dispute about the amount of tax that is due by the taxpayer. But what we would like to be able to do is arrive at a position where we could set off that amount that is due against other tax or other revenues that we are holding. So essentially it's to arrive at an agreed net position in relation to the taxpayer. So As regards set-off, the protection for the taxpayer there is that the amount that is due is undisputed. We've agreed it between us. I think the other thing too, in relation to the provisions that we're seeking, particularly around set-off, we have to look at those within the context of how our organisation operates generally. So, you know, we have a really strong reputation for acting proportionately. It's a discretionary power. You know, we have our charter of values that we are held to account to in terms of our operations, which the Ombudsman regulates us around. So there is no suggestion, certainly from our part here, that the provisions in relation to set-off would be something that would be seen to be a sort of heavy-handed power for us to have. We're also conscious that other tax administrations within these Isles have this power set out in legislation. We think that we have common law powers in relation to this in Scotland. The issue we have with that, though, is it's the lack of certainty and clarity for taxpayers. So if it's set out in the legislation, there's no dispute or no doubt about the ability for us to arrive at an arrangement such as set off.
Yes, it seems to be very rarely used in actual fact where it does exist at the moment. But I just want to ask two further questions before I open up to colleagues. Now, it goes back to this issue about 350 quarries. Now, you've said that there's 150 current UK taxpayers who have been identified who are likely to be required to register for SAT. I take it that includes people with multiple quarries. Right, OK, so that's not like 150 plus 200 illegitimate ones, so to speak, no, because you don't know how many of them there are. Would that be right in saying that? Yeah.
So
just want clarification on those numbers. And then, and my last question is really is also about clarification of numbers. It's just with regard to financial memorandum, and it looks example in table 3 of the financial memorandum gives a summary of estimated revenue Scotland running costs for the first year of SAT. The numbers are all very kind of rounded, it looks to me. So for example, amortisation, which of course is a great word, the spreading of the cost of an intangible asset, such as an IT system, that's £200,000. Operational staff costs £645,000. Operational non-staff costs £60,000. So what's saying is that once this is all done and dusted, the costs would be about £905,000 a year. So I'm just wondering what the kind of parameters are for that. So how accurate is that to be is that within 5%, 10%, 20% limits? How confident are you that the figures in the financial memorandum are accurate for the setup costs and importantly for these ongoing operational costs?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. So obviously the costs that we have built up here are based on our knowledge of what it costs to run our existing taxes. Mm-hmm. It's based on our understanding of what is going to be expected of us in terms of administration at this point in time. And it's been looked at very carefully, recognising the constraints that the Scottish government is under in terms of funding. So we've had to be very prudent in what we are seeking here. John knows more detail though, so I'm going to hand over to John in case there's anything else you want to add, John.
Excellent. Yeah, the staffing costs are broadly based on, as Elaine has mentioned, the two existing taxes that we operate. Again, the assumption is based on the Scottish aggregates tax broadly being similar to the UK aggregates levy. But the staffing costs, yeah, given what we know to date, we're confident that both the staffing costs and the timeline we have for implementation are fairly accurate, but obviously we need to keep revisiting that as the legislation develops. In terms of both the implementation costs and the first year running costs, I would say we're comfortable with the figures that we've put in the financial memorandum.
Yeah, comfortable isn't really very numeric from my perspective. That's what I'm asking. Is it a 5, 10% confidence limits, 20%? What kind of ballpark are we talking about? Because obviously financial memorandum have to be best estimates. So I'm just wondering how confident you are.
So the unknown here for us, if I'm honest, is what happens with pay. Our biggest cost is our is our staff costs, as you can see. So the unknown for us
that would
here
be today's prices, though, obviously, wouldn't it? You're setting that.
And what we know around the, yes, around the pay deal. So that's where our risk is, if you like, is because this will depend on future negotiations that we have with Scottish Government around our funding for our staff costs. But within this, we haven't built any cushion, if that's what you're looking for,
no,
in terms of 5 or 10%.
I'm not looking at cushion. I'm not saying, you know, I'm just saying, you know, these figures, you know, are they accurate to what degree, effectively? You know what I mean? Because that's what we're trying to say. I mean, we've actually financial memorandums, as you're probably well aware, where, you know, they've changed by hundreds of millions of pounds over the space of a year. So that's why I'm trying to pin you down a wee bit to say, well, it may go up or down 5%, but that's we're absolutely confident that these are the figures, rather than figures that, you know, this time next year could be completely different.
Just to come in with more certainty for you then.
Yes.
These figures are figures that we are confident that we can live within. They are small. You know, our staff costs, for example, if we are confident that this is the number of staff that we would require. So the only variable there is going to be if there's something that we are unaware of that happens in relation to pay arrangements. Our non-staff costs are a small amount, and we've got flexibility within there to keep that within control. Amortisation is an accounting treatment.
You've got excited about that, aren't you?
Yes, which is obviously based on what we believe the cost of the system is going to be. So I can say to you with some certainty that we think these will be the operational costs that we need to live within. We can manage it.
Okay, well, with that content response, I shall move on to John to be followed by Liz.
Thank you very much, convener. One of the points that the Chartered Institute of Taxation raised was they thought there might be a bit of confusion when we start off with a new tax, because operators who have just been used to United Kingdom tax are suddenly going to have to do with either both or just the Scottish one. So can you say anything about how you would be thinking about raising awareness in the industry?
Certainly, I can certainly start off with that, and James and John can both come in. So one of the benefits that we have with the introduction being in 2026, as is currently planned, if the parliamentary timetable for legislation is as is currently planned, which means that we should have hopefully the secondary legislation in by March 2025, gives us a full year for really active, proactive engagement with the industry. But as we've said in my opening statement, what's really important to us is that we make sure that the industry is ready and understands its obligations. And if I can draw from our experience from our other taxes, we've done that through a variety of means. We work through the representative industry associations. We'll be running webinars and outreach events to taxpayers that they can come along and they can find out more about the tax. We'll be engaging with the professional bodies. You know, we'll be doing a whole range of things. But what we'll also have to do, part of what we will also be needing to do in terms of internally, is making sure our guidance, our taxpayer guidance, is available on our website early enough. So we've got a strand of the programme which will be working on that, so that in good time we've got our website updated, we've got our guidance updated, and then it's a lot of outreach to the taxpayers to assist them in their understanding. Mm-hmm. But you know, it is clear, with it being such a change, the communications and engagement with the industry and the representative bodies and professional advisers is going to be really important here.
Is that what these go-live events are? It says from January 26 to July 26.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
And an operator based in England who isn't even aware that we're going to have a new tax, how will they learn about it?
Yes, well, that's a subset of a challenge, if you have this challenge, if you like. So, I mean, again, our outreach is going to be really important there. I don't know whether, looking at James, it looks like he can come in. I'm sure we'll be able to use our relationships with HMRC to help with that. But, James, do you want to come in?
You picked up on the point I wanted to raise, that, we've had a good relationship with HMRC so far. They've been quite a collaborative relationship, and there will be points, joint points of work, such as communications with taxpayers that we'll need to address together. So HMRC will be helpful in be able to identify those taxpayers that may have to, for example, register for the Scottish Aggregates Tax that is based in England, and through those, through that understanding, we'll be able to have a joint comms approach, which will help identify the taxpayers and make sure they understand their obligations before that tax goes live.
Okay. Yes, if we could come in as well. We've worked closely with our colleagues in Scottish Government in the Bill team as they've put together their expert advisory group, and we've been part of that advisory group. And we've also developed a comprehensive stakeholder engagement plan, which at the moment we are probably, you know, a little bit in the background with Scottish Government Bill team leading because of where we are with the programme. But we have a fully developed engagement plan in place. And our intention is to utilise that advisory group right up till go live and beyond, and keep that relationship going with the industry because it's been extremely valuable to us.
Okay. Now, you say that the tax return is going to be a bit different from the one that's used for the UK system, and I think there's going to be more detail in our tax return. Can you explain why that is and what's going to happen?
Yep. Certainly, our intention at this point is to seek slightly different information than what is already provided by taxpayers for the UK tax. The committee will be aware of our really strong record in relation to data and the data that we publish as an organisation. And we also find that, of course, the data that we have access to really helps inform our compliance approach. So the rationale for us seeking slightly more information on the tax return is to assist us in our understanding of the industry, but also to assist us in our compliance work that will come forward. I'll hand over to James, though, because I think the other thing, too, that we want to make sure is that we're not placing an unnecessary burden on the industry. So for us, it's getting the balance right between the information that would be really, truly helpful for us to have and making sure that the industry is not unduly burdened by us. So, James, yep. You can see what
Thanks,
we've done
Elaine.
So far.
Again, you've covered a lot of the points I want to discuss, but yeah, I would say that and balancing off the information that we want. So, for example, what's currently asked for as part of the UK return, we've evaluated that and then looked at how, for example, the tax is calculated. And as part of the tax calculation, some of the key areas are exemptions and reliefs that forms. Then there's quite a lot of reliefs and exemptions to think about, and they can relate to compliance. So we've considered as part of the return it might be more valuable to ask for some more details about those exemptions and reliefs. Now, balancing that against, as Elaine says, you can't be overly burdensome to the taxpayer, but currently, although not provided in the UK return, the information has to be retained by taxpayers legislatively. There's a requirement for records to be kept, plus through engagement of going to quarry sites and looking at their processes and how managed they've got to be about what's on their site and what goes out their site, because it's, you know, low value, high volume systems. So they've got to make sure they understand the materials and the profits that they'll make. We're quite confident that we'll be able to ask for information that taxpayers will be able to provide with ease. And we'll have work with stakeholders throughout the process. So we'll design the return, we'll design our system, and it'll be a collaborative approach with stakeholders to ensure that we meet that balance.
Okay, thank you. Another point the Chartered Institute made was that there could be double penalties in some situations, in that a quarry operator could be subject to a penalty of 100% of the tax, but also so could a customer, and they felt that was a bit harsh to be penalising both 100%.
Yeah, I can comment to that. Yes, that's in relation to a specific penalty for a tax credit in relation to prescribed industrial or agricultural processes. So on review and as part of advice to the Scottish Government for Stage 2 amendments, we're looking to advise that penalty should be removed, and we're all going to rely on the already existing RSTPA penalty, so our existing tax framework penalty, which deals with the information supplied by third parties to a taxpayer that may be incorrect. So that issue should fall away.
Okay. Thanks for that. So in part two of the bill, there's a few issues, one being automation, that I think the government would be able to give you powers to do more automation. Can you say anything around that and what protections there would be? Because some people do like a bit of face-to-face and personal interaction as well as computers.
Yes, of course. I understand that totally. Obviously, as you've identified, the bill is setting out powers for the Minister to bring forward regulations in relation to automation. So obviously there would be, as I understand it, it would be through the affirmative procedure. So there would be consultation and discussion as part of that. Automation is one of the things that we really want to have access to as an organisation to properly harness the benefits of the technology that we've got. But we're also a tax authority that has got to make judgment calls and decisions on sometimes quite complex tax matters. So our need for automation, our use of automation as we see it at this point, is going to be at the very straightforward end of our processes, where there's no doubt about a basic penalty being due because a date that was due to be met has passed and a return hasn't been received, for example. So it's things like that that we are interested in introducing automation for, because it will keep us efficient. It will mean that I don't need to, as we take on more taxes, I'm not needing to build up teams of people unnecessarily. And it means that the staff that we employ can focus on more complex work, richer work, if you like, for them as individuals, where we are training them in terms of, you know, the sophistication of our tax legislation, how to deploy judgment in relation to the casework.
I mean, I'm pretty sure we're all sympathetic to that. I think we've been given cases in the past when we've looked at AI that, you know, sometimes if there's not enough human oversight, things can get run away. And as I mentioned to the previous panel, you know, I've seen constituents who were a penny short in their council tax, and then they get these horrendous letters from somebody. You know, can you give us some assurance that we're not going down that route?
Well, I would hope we're not going to go down that route. We certainly wouldn't be designing automation with it to come out with that sort of result at the end of it. And I think what I would say is that one of the things I have learned in this role is that sometimes things do go wrong. We won't always get things right. And I think what matters to us as an organisation, if we were to issue a letter such like that in error, we would make it right with the relevant taxpayer. And our whole approach would be one which was empathetic with the situation that we had landed them with. But certainly in the way in which we would design any of our automation of our processes, we would be looking to make sure that sort of error wouldn't occur.
OK, thank you. And the final point on a different area. In the Law Society's evidence concerning group relief and demergers, they effectively said that HMRC guidance overrules the strict letter of the law, but Revenue Scotland has not been able to give the same. It's not proved possible for Revenue Scotland to get issued guidance which has the same effect as for SDLT. Can you explain anything about that?
Certainly, I would never have thought our organisation would have the powers to issue guidance which overrules the legislation that this Parliament's passed. Our guidance is to
HMRC has a bit of a reputation for doing that.
Well, I'd like to think our organisation does not.
Okay.
We're aware of what the Law Society is seeking in terms of those other amendments. Clearly, that's a matter for ministers as to whether they wish to bring these forward. My team are telling me that operationally, should these changes be brought forward, they are not going to create a significant operational issue for us.
Okay, thanks, convener.
Q-Liz.
Thank you, Mrs. Lorimer.
You said in answer to the convener that one of the advantages you think this devolved tax will have is that there'll be better compliance. As in picking up some of the people who've been going through the loopholes, and that's obviously very good news for extra revenue. In your opinion, given what you know about the UK tax levy, which we've had for around 20 years, do you foresee other benefits from this devolved tax that will actually likely raise the revenue from what exists currently?
our hope would be that through the compliance work that we will do, that we will improve the revenue situation. At the moment, though, because we don't know enough about the industry, and because we haven't gone out and visited every single taxpayer, and we haven't engaged across the whole of Scotland with all the different local authorities, the level of non-compliance to us is at the moment, it's not, I can't put a figure to it, it's not known. What we're hearing from the industry is that in some areas it's really quite significant. Okay. So I think where we can add value initially is going to be around our approach to compliance and making sure that the taxpayers that we have, that we know, are paying the right amount of tax, and then we'll broaden our reach out to find those taxpayers who are should be taxpayers who are not paying the right level of tax.
So in relation to the work that Mr Lindsay spoke about, where Revenue Scotland's obviously been speaking to HMRC, has HMRC flagged up any issues where they're obviously concerned?
I'll take it first, James. I mean, James can answer in relation to have HMRC raised anything, but I'm not aware of that. James might be able to tell you whether they have or they haven't. Certainly, from what I understand, though, the industry have raised issues with us, which we have passed on to HMRC. I think that's the right way round, isn't it?
We do speak to HMRC and the compliance team and the policy teams to kind of understand how they do things at this point in time. What's the landscape like? What's the tax administration and compliance like? But I think I would like to stress that the willingness to engage from industry stakeholders from over the last 18 months has been really welcoming and helpful. The compliance issues that they've raised with us are clear, and I think that we could have a really good chance to have a good impact to deal with those compliance issues. I'm confident that we can, and I'm confident that the impact that we'll have and the real benefit that we can bring to the table here is that we can improve that sector by dealing with those compliance issues, dealing with that non-level playing field that bothers them, and it can have a real impact locally for businesses, jobs, that all the things that are really important. So there is real benefit for this tax to be involved and the real benefit for us that we can bring to the table.
I mean, that's all very encouraging, because I mean, the bottom line here is that, you know, if the tax to be successful, obviously there's got to be good compliance, it's got to be seen to be fair, and people understand what it's for, and also, you know, in terms of raising revenue, it's vital that, you know, there are some benefits from that revenue raising aspect, because that's obviously the basis for why the Scottish Government would like to introduce it. My second question is one that came up in the earlier session, and it's been around this committee for some time, about the possibility of a finance bill which allows or would allow the Parliament, not just this committee, to be able to scrutinise taxation a bit more fully than is currently the case, and with greater clarity and understanding that. Is that something, I know you can't comment on Scottish Government policy, but is that something that would help the process of getting more people to understand what's going on?
Oh, I think so, yes. This has been something that I have been asking for since I arrived in this role, which is a while ago now. I really think, as part of a mature tax system in Scotland, we need to have the ability to keep our legislation up to date. We need to have the ability to keep it up to date from a technical perspective, and some of the part two pieces we've got here, you can see why we're looking for it, for automation, for example. But there's actually also, there's a need to keep the substance of our tax legislation up to date too. And without a regular vehicle to do that, we run the risk of our tax legislation falling behind, or our ability to ensure proper compliance, our ability to ensure fairness across the system, to be brought into doubt. And so, as an organisation, we are really keen to have that vehicle. Much of the changes that we would like to see are, I would describe them as boring technical, but nonetheless important.
Boring technical can be good.
Boring technical can be good, that's right. So I don't think it's something that we would require sort of annually, but we certainly need to have a vehicle. Yeah. And at the moment, we don't have that. And okay. The longer we administer our taxes, the longer the list is going to become of the issues that we want to see changed.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. And we would never describe Michelle as boring and technical. Michelle.
Why did I know there was going to be a comment about that? Thank you, convener. Perhaps, I mean, a couple of areas are interrelated. We heard from our earlier panel some concerns about offset or set off, I think you described it off, describing it as heavy-handed. Now, what I asked was that, but surely you're establishing a principled approach in anticipation of further taxes being devolved, that where people owe tax, that we should be able to claw that back. Am I correct in my assumption?
Yes, I would say you are. And so essentially that particular provision, what we are saying is we would like to have that clarified in legislation now, because we would like to have it for aggregates, but we would also like to have it for all of our taxes. We know that we can anticipate that we will have taxpayers that are taxpayers for more than one tax, for example. Mm-hmm. We can anticipate that we'll have landfill operators who also run quarries. So it just makes sense for us to be able to have that. And I hope the assurances I gave earlier around certainty around the amount that's due, that not being in doubt between us, and the fact that we would act proportionately is sufficient assurance to you for you to feel that you could enable us to have those powers set out in the legislation.
And following on from that, I think it was the Law Society that commented that, yeah, but further taxes might not align directly. And that is true, but I suppose I think it can't be beyond the wit of yourselves and Parliament to design legislation that takes account of that. And I suppose following on, would then the principle of a finance bill allow for the sort of scrutiny that you would want to see of how you can continue that offsetting, bless you, that offsetting approach?
I mean, certainly we would like the provisions that are within Part 2 passed, obviously, as part of this bill. But yes, for ongoing maintenance of our operation of those provisions, because it would be enshrined, because the set-off provisions are within primary legislation, yes, we would, if it can't be amended by secondary legislation, a finance bill coming forward would provide us with Parliament with the opportunity to scrutinise our utilisation of that power in due course. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Jimmy.
I've just wanted to go back to the compliance issue that the convener and Liz Smith raised. I appreciate you can't give a figure for the exact number, but you have talked a little bit about some of the areas. I think, Mr. McVeigh, you talked about farmers providing aggregates kind of under the radar. I can assure you, if 100 tons was taken off my land, it'd be pretty obvious to folk. But I mean, we're still not talking about huge numbers. For example, if 100 tons was taken, my understanding that would be £200 of tax. So it'd be interesting to see how that would almost be worth the risk for someone. I'm just wondering if you have any idea, because everything seems to have been very anecdotal so far on that. Any idea in the split between some of these smaller? Non-compliance issues and some of the larger ones, because as the convener rightly pointed out, this isn't a big country. Quarries are pretty obvious; they can't be moved or hidden very easily. So, do you have any idea of the balance?
Balance between the two, I'm not sure we have at this stage. I'm going to look to James just in case he does.
In terms of quantitative data, we don't have anything substantial at this point in time. But in terms of qualitative data from the industry stakeholders, they've been very clear that the impact is quite great for them, and that there is an issue to be dealt with that is currently not being dealt with. And then we have seen evidence of quite large scale, to some degree, unregistered taxpayers that continue, even not just as pop-up as my colleague mentioned, but continue for years. And one thing maybe to point out is that although quarry sites can be big, they can be hidden. So it can be hidden in plain view. You can't see them off the road. So you've got 200 yards down the road, and then you've got a big hole that's been dug out and loads of aggregate that's been taken from it. And that won't be seen by the public, for example, but it is felt by industry. And it's felt by the community, because a community might only have, for example, say, three quarries in it, say, a local authority. And if someone's undercutting them, they know. That's the benefit for us, that the industry, they can be our, you know, ears to the ground. We can use them, and they're willing to engage with us on those points. So when, as part of our stakeholder engagement and after the task goes live, we'll work with them in order for them to tell us, because they'll be quite willing to come to us to say that you know, that quarry down the road is undercutting us. Can you help us with that?
I mean, depending on what kind of community a quarry operating will have impact, and people will know about it. It might not be seen from the road, but the trucks will be seen. Just on that point, why is it you think the industry it will work with you, and you will have more impact, or you'll be more successful in dealing with that than under the previous UK Agri Survey?
I'll come in there. I think it's simply because we've reached out, because they're aware of the impact we've had in other industries in Scotland. And I think they recognise that they've actually got people that will come out and visit them and people that will speak to them. I think we have to remember that, and this is no criticism of HMRC at all, but you know, UK aggregates tax in the wider scheme of things for HMRC is a small tax. So, you know, with it being one of the benefits about it being devolved and for us to operationalise it, is it will be our third tax, so it will get the attention that you would expect us to give it.
And how will you decide the kind of cost benefits of that, of pursuing unregistered quarries, sort of like, because obviously it will be expensive, or it could be expensive, and the benefits may be small, other than the general approach to ensuring people that should be paying tax are. But so how do you think you'll do that, and what kind of resource will you be able to put to it?
Yeah, so the resources that we are hoping to deploy to this tax we've set out in the financial memorandum. Our Scottish Government have set it out on our behalf in the financial memorandum. In terms of the approach we take, our starting point is that we would expect everybody to pay the right amount of tax. Obviously, there comes a point, though, when we are looking at our compliance approach, we do it on what we call a risk basis. So our starting point will be to go for where the greater risks are. And it's only once that we have got those risks resolved will we move to the lower level risks. So we take a proportionate view in terms of where we deploy our compliance resource. At the end of the day, though, it's incumbent on us as a tax authority to, if we are aware of non-compliance, we have to do something about it. We can't turn a blind eye to it. But we take a proportionate view about where we deploy our resources, so that we are tackling the greatest risks of non-compliance first.
And I mean, do you have any estimates on the kind of cost of non-compliance at the moment?
The cost of non-compliance,
yeah.
Do you mean in terms of revenue loss?
Yeah.
No, I'm not able to provide you with that. I'm sorry.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Convener. The Law Society said in their evidence that arrangements for penalties and appeals should reflect the desire to ensure compliance rather than being used as a mechanism to raise revenue, and that the penalties should themselves be well publicised. As part of your engagement with industry, is that publication of those potential penalties and consequences for non-compliance being communicated? And do you feel that the balance is being struck right at the moment between that desire to improve compliance rather than unnecessarily being used to raise revenue?
Yes, the penalties regime. The penalties regime that's set out in the Revenue Scotland Tax and Powers Act is a pretty complex regime. And that is the regime that will apply here. So, yes, absolutely, we will be making sure that the industry are aware of the penalties regime and how it applies to them. It starts with making sure you get your tax return in on time. If you get your tax return in on time, you're off to a flying start.
Where our penalty regime becomes more complex is where it's, you know, that it's not in on time, and then, you know, it continues and continues and continues, and you become, you get into a very complex calculation in relation to what is due in terms of penalty. So yes, our starting point will not be to at all use the penalties regime to raise revenue. We would much rather we weren't issuing penalties. If we weren't issuing penalties, it would mean that tax returns are in on time and the right amount of tax is being paid. So you're right to identify that what we need to be able to do is engage with the industry, because the penalties regime is one of the sticks we have as a tax authority, which we would rather not use. It would be better if they understood what their responsibilities were early on, that our system made the making of a tax return straightforward for them. They knew what they had to put in terms of their information in that tax return. They do it on time. There shouldn't be any need for the penalties regime to apply.
That's great. Are there any other operational issues, especially in the early days of the scheme being live, that you foresee? Sometimes there have been issues, for example, getting data across from HMRC, as well as other issues. Is that something that you foresee as potentially being an issue, or are those being worked out at the moment?
No, we will. I might bring in John here. We will, as we have with our other taxes, we have formal arrangements with HMRC for sharing data. We're empowered to do that under our legislation. It's very tightly constrained, obviously, because what we're doing is essentially sharing information about taxpayers. We'll have that for this tax in the same as we have for our other taxes. So our intention would be to have that sort of arrangement in place specifically. I don't think, though, John, we're expecting data to transfer at the start of this, are we? We're starting from scratch.
Starting from scratch, but working closely with HMRC at the moment, and obviously putting together a joint plan for the smooth transition for go live. So, good communications with HMRC up to this point.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Gillian. And that's exhausted questions from colleagues around the table. I would just say that compliance does, of course, of itself surely increase revenue, even if that's not the reason for it. One of the issues I think at the moment that we're grappling with, apart from things like lack of data, and we don't really know how big the issue is there doesn't seem to have been much in terms of enforcement over the last 20 or so years. I mean, you said yourself this is a small tax, but individuals get chased by HMRC for just a few pounds sometimes, or so it seems to me odd that, you know, an industry which does generate tens of millions of pounds in revenue in Scotland alone seems to be able to decide almost on a voluntary basis whether or not it pays the tax. Is that a fair comment, or do you think that's a wee bit?
I don't think, Convener, you can expect me to comment on that.
Okay, fair enough. We'll put all the really nasty questions next week when the Minister's with us. Are there any further points you want to make before we wind up this session? Is there anything you feel we haven't covered that you want to get over, you and your colleagues?
I don't think so. Yeah. Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to explain where we're at the current stage with this tax, and look forward to coming back in due course. No doubt you will want to see us again as the legislation progresses, because we will then be getting into much more detail about our operational readiness. So very happy to come at any point to see you.
Well, thank you very much. I want to thank all the witnesses for their contributions today. We'll continue our evidence taking on the bill next week, when we'll hear from the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, the legendary one and only Tom Arthur, MSP. As that is the final item on our agenda, I now close this meeting. Thank you all.